Hi, I'm Max Keiser. This is the Keiser Report. Well, what we've been reporting on for a few years, money printing leads to inflation. This is now becoming a big problem for central banks around the world. Only one central bank in the world is actually taking it on board and proactively dealing with the issue. We'll get to that in a moment. Stacy.
Right. Well, the money printing has been going across, of course, the U.S., across Europe, Japan. They've all been printing money. Japan's the first to go money printer, go years and years ago, decades ago. But we're going to get to the Central Bank of Russia is apparently going to be raising rates yet again in a shock and awe moment. But first, I want to lay out the situation of what's going on and why we have this wealth and income gap and just the extraordinary moment in which we are. We've covered the extraordinary nature of negative interest rates. We've covered the extraordinary nature of the money printing and negative energy prices, all the crazy things that happen when price signals go astray. Well, households, corporate equities, and mutual fund shares, asset market value levels have expanded by $8.8 trillion in asset value between Q4 2019 and Q1 2021, the fastest and largest valuation expansion in history. So you kind of see that in the data where you see that the Fed's interventions get sharper and faster and harder. So that's after the 2000-2001 dot-com crash. It was a slow decline for a few years, like 4 or 5 years, and then it hit bottom and slowly came back to life. Here's the 2008 crash. You see, and what you see is that there's a kind of like a U-shaped bottom. We had a V-shaped week of declines back in March of 2020, and now asset valuations have gone parabolic.
We've been tracking that exact progress from the money printing and what it does, and we're at the inflection point now. You can't mask it anymore like they used to, because remember, financial engineers on Wall Street, they were able to figure out a way to print money but have it go around the labor market, right? So wages have been flat in the before this recent derivatives-led financial engineering era that we live in. When money supply increased, wages would go up, you see, and that was a price signal, and then you'd have the business cycle. The bankers, starting with Alan Greenspan, figured out how to just ignore labor completely and let wages stagnate and just give the money directly to their friends on Wall Street and their benefactors. And, okay, so they said that there's no inflation, but under COVID, they had to start printing directly and shipping it right from the Treasury, as we've reported. It's not like a central bank operation anymore. It's direct money printing. And on top of the structural collapse that's been occurring for a while, and this is now leading to a hyperinflation. The bankers themselves now admit inflation. They say it's transitory, which is a lie. Of course, it's structural. It's going to be a secular inflationary move. Only one bank in the world is taking this seriously. That's the Bank of Russia.
Right. But let's talk about this moment of asset prices increasing exponentially, because we've seen exponential growth. Everybody now in the world understands this because of COVID, right? You see how viruses spread exponentially. It looks slow at first, and then it goes parabolic. Well, that's kind of what has happened with debt and fiat. So we're 50 years in August. It'll be 50 years that we have an all-fiat world. And we have increasingly interventionist central banks, especially in the Western world. And so what you've seen is a sort of doubling and quadrupling, tupling, octupling, doubling down on all your bad bets and leverage. So it makes sense because, you know, the Fed steps in, the Greenspan put, the Yellen put, the Bernanke put, all that stuff, they come in and rescue. So it makes sense that it incentivizes this doubling down and increasing of leverage. So we're at that parabolic move now, especially if you put it on top of a finite economy. We also have a similar thing with the network effect, the exponential growth of networks. We saw that with the internet. But I want to turn to this tweet from Willie Wu, who's talking about Bitcoin and what you're seeing with Bitcoin penetration. The Human Genome Project launched in 1990. By 1998, it was at 2% progress. So it took 8 years to get to 2%. The project reached completion by 2003. This is the nature of exponential growth. Bitcoin's adoption doubles every year. It is currently at 2% global penetration. Slowly, slowly, then all at once. And here's that chart. Well,
right, there, you know, think of lily pads, right, in a pond, right? That's exponential growth. And that's why it's shocking to people. The human mind can't really take this on board. So whether it's the Human Genome Project or the internet or Bitcoin or debt. Now, what we're saying about debt is that the debt's been increased and been doubling for years and years and years. And now we're at a point where the next bailout of these banks, and they're going to get bailed out again. They have to double the money supply again. They have to double M1 again. So that means they have to go from, what is it now, 10 trillion or so, to 20 or 25 trillion in one collapse, in the dollar collapse. And that's what Bitcoin's been telling us all along. And, you know, it's amazing that these PhDs from Yale, like Ben Bernanke, or Nobel Prize winning economists like Paul Krugman at the New York Times, you know, it's incredible that they have gainful employment writing about this stuff. And of course, when it all happens, they'll say they never saw it coming. They'll blame it on something else. Paul Krugman will blame it on aliens. They're already seeding the alien argument by claiming that there's a lot more UFOs out there.
You see the parabolic move. And now what do you see? The parabolic move into Bitcoin, because Bitcoin is for millennial and Generation Z. They see the numbers. They see the mathematics there that the exponential debt is not something. They're way too late to the Ponzi scheme of the fiat grid to participate, right? So they're just going to go to Bitcoin. You see that in even places like India. This number is young Indians are turning to crypto instead of gold. A follow-up to that is Indians invested $38.8 billion in Bitcoin and crypto in the last 12 months, a huge 19,900% increase from 200 million just 1 year ago. You know, obviously gold is very ingrained in the population as a store of value. Now, the younger people there in India are buying Bitcoin and adopting Bitcoin.
Yeah, there has to be a word for something that means deja vu, but a continuous deja vu that is like annoyingly deja vu-like. Because, you know, this Indian story, the Indian population having 20,000 tons of gold is totally ingrained in their culture, their civilization for thousands of years, that gold is the way to go. And for 5 years now, since we first invested in Unicoin 5 years ago, the first Bitcoin exchange in India, we've been saying the Indian mindset's gonna shift to Bitcoin. And every time we say that, people have said, remember we predicted a sovereign would take on Bitcoin like they have in El Salvador? We predicted India would take on Bitcoin. We predicted the hash wars. We predicted geothermal energy.
Right. In fact, there was a tweet stream somebody just retweeted from 2013 where you were Dean Baker, who is an economist, was, you know, you were laughing at Japan going down the road of more money printing. And you said, hey, I've got my Bitcoin. And, you know, Bitcoin was like $500 then. He's like, yeah, good luck with that. Keep buying it, buddy. And obviously that's up many, many times over that. But again, you mentioned mindset. That mindset just shifts suddenly, and then you can't ever go back, right? So once these young people now, they're all in Bitcoin, they see Bitcoin as digital gold, and there's no going back. They're not going to adopt their mom and grandmom's, you know, gold standard. So the mindset, and we talk about this all the time, about the shifting mindset of the younger generation and the split that's happening. And you see that in the words of Elvira Nabiulina of the Central Bank of Russia, what she's saying about why their plan to basically shock and awe the markets with an interest rate increase. While Fed is in denial, hawkish Bank of Russia sees inflation as not transitory, warns of possible shock and awe rate hike. So consumer price inflation in Russia is red hot, having jumped 6% in May compared to a year ago, 2 percentage points above the Bank of Russia's target of 4%. Polls in Russia show that food inflation is a top concern, currently running at 7.4%. But he points out that, you know, they're increasing rates, while the Fed is saying that this bump in all the commodity prices and food inflation and all that stuff is just transitory. So they keep on surprising to the upside. They keep on surprising economists. In fact, Wall Street says Russia has been on the opposite trajectory of the US Fed, surprising economists at every step along the way. This trajectory started on March 19 with a 25 basis point hike to 4.5% against the expectations of 27 of the 28 economists polled by Reuters who didn't expect a rate hike. On April 23rd, the Bank of Russia hiked its policy rate by 50 basis points to 5%. On June 11th, it hiked it another 50 basis points to 5.5%. The next policy meeting is scheduled for July 23rd, and the Central Bank of Russia has warned that it will expect to increase rates between 25 basis points and 100 basis points.
Right. Well, she's defending the currency. She's defending the ruble. That's the job of the central bank. to be, you know, to defend your national interest using interest rates. Only in the United States has the central bank abdicated their role of defending the rights of Americans in favor of the kleptocratic privileges of the oligarchs. Oligarchs that run America. Oligarchs that run America.
Right. So the other thing is that a lot of economies, Russia being one of them, but many economies around the world don't like a lot of debt. So the U.S. seems to think that's a solution, I think, that, okay, we'll just create another quadrillion in bad debts, and that will cause inflation to mask the inflation. They'll have deflation to mask the inflation. Well, you know, they seem to, like, try to balance those out rather than the price of money.
Right. So deflation is another, more accurately, should be referred to as a soft default.
Yes.
So
yes.
America's defaulting on their debt again, as they did in 1971. It was a massive default on American debt. They're defaulting on their debt again. And when you default on your debt, and Russia's already completely out of the dollar,